Me that we are beginning today. I don't know how many sessions we will have on that. So let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the wisdom, for the power, for the anointing of your word, O Lord God. Hallelujah. Lord, we depend upon your word to be successful and fruitful and to live our life in a way that is pleasing to you. And Lord, give us hearts that are steadfast, that are thirsty, that are humble and obedient, Lord. Lord God, speak to us today by your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. So we'll start with verse number 1. Chapter 1, verse 1. Good place to start with a book. When you read, you start at page number 1, line number 1 on the top. So that says here, these are the words that Moses spoke to all people of Israel while they were in the wilderness east of the Jordan River. They were camped in the Jordan Valley, and then he gives us a very clear area where they were. So they were in the valley, in the plain of Moab, quite high, but you know, in the valley, and then they could see the promised land on the other side. And the book of Deuteronomy begins with, these are the words. And you know why the book Deuteronomy is called Deuteronomy? It comes from the Latin Old Testament version of the Torah, the Septuagint. And it is Deuteronomy, which means second law. But the Hebrew title, the Hebrew Bibles, calls it simply, these are the words. That's the Hebrew names. These are the words. The other one is Deuteronomy, second law. So, because it comes from the first verse. They were east of the Jordan, and at this point, Israel were camped in that plain, and they could see on the other side. They were just on the verge of entering into the promised land that had been promised to the patriarch more than 400 years before. So they were just right there at the border, ready to go in. And the children who had left Egypt, who maybe were not even born at the time when they left Egypt, were now a generation of adults. You see, now when I look at my son, he's already 41 year old. I have a son 41 year old. Wow. He was just this little boy. But the generation, it grows like this, you know. So this new generation of now adults were ready to conquer the promised land. They were ready to enter. But before this could happen, Moses gave 3 long speeches, which are the books, and 3 different parts, 3 long speeches, reinstating the law. You know, when we went through the book of Leviticus and Exodus and Leviticus, the 10 commandments were given at the foot of Mount Sinai. The first generation, they saw the fire, they heard the voice of God, and when they established the tabernacle there, all the priesthood, the Levitical priesthood, was given to them. So this, all of these generation of adults perish in the wilderness. Now we are 38 years later, and then this is a brand new generation. God had promised that all of these disobedient, rebellious first generation, they didn't believe God, they didn't obey God. He says, okay. And they were accusing God. Remember, they were accusing God. You brought us here in the wilderness to make us die here in the wilderness. We have no food, we have nothing. You made us come here and our children will perish in the wilderness. That is how they perceive God. Says, okay, I'll take you at your word. You are telling us that I have sent you here to have your children die in the wilderness. Your children will enter the land, but you will not because of this disobedience. So here is this new generation. They are just ready. And now Moses, with a heavy and passionate heart, is going to give them 3 long sermons about the expectation of God. They will renew the covenant, all the social law, because they are going to become the special society, the special cultural people that will reflect the character of God among the nations. They are going to be holy. They are going to be different. They are going to live not like, they're not going to enter the land and live. God was chasing these pagan nations because they were evil. So there is not going to let his people Israel enter and practice the same old ways. So he's training them, he's preparing them, and he's giving them the law over here. The book, the Old Testament surveys, introduced Deuteronomy in saying it is a treasure chest of theological concept that have influenced the religious thought and life of ancient Israelites and of Christians today. The Thompson Bible writer says the influence of Deuteronomy on the domestic and personal religion of all ages has not been surpassed by any other book in the Bible. It is quoted over 80 times in the New Testament, to which the early Christians made frequent reference. It is quoted a lot in the New Testament, but it is quoted in most of the book of the Old Testament too. David quotes it. The prophets refer to the book of Deuteronomy. It is definitely one of the core book of the Bible. The Israelites spent 40 years on a journey that should have lasted 11 days. Can you imagine that? You are on a journey, you're going there from here to there, supposed to take 2 weeks, and it takes you 40 years. Wow, what went wrong? Maybe they turned right instead of left or something like this. But it was not the distance that was the problem. It was the condition of their hearts. And that is always true with any generations of believers, and it is still true with us today. It's never the distance. It's never the journey. It's never the circumstances. It's always our hearts. Either they are in the right conditions to move with God, or they are rebellious, they are careless, they are indifferent, they are not listening, so they cannot obey and they cannot receive the blessing of God. It's never the distance, it's always the heart. What good was the promised land if the Israelites were just as wicked as the nations already living there? That would make no sense, isn't it? Why God would chase other wicked nations and replace it with another wicked nations? That wouldn't make sense. So the journey was been painful. Why? Because of the unbelief and the rebellious heart of the people. But this painful journey was also necessary as part of the preparation. Through this journey, God taught them who He was. And God taught the people who they were. And that is very important, so that you and I, when we walk with God, that we understand clearly through the scriptures who God is, but also understand our identity. You know, there's a lot of Christians that do not live fully their life. They are not content. They are not really like embracing the wisdom of the Word of God. They don't know how to live their Christian lives. They are up and down. They are confused. They are living the flesh. And many times under condemnation, when the Bible says there is no condemnation, there's a lot of shame. There's a lot of confusion because we don't understand our identity in Christ Jesus. So understanding our identity is very important. And in the book of Deuteronomy will help the people of Israel, and it will help us to understand who we are meant to be like. So God gave His rebellious people the law, number one, to help them understand their own sinfulness. You know, like Paul talks about that in the New Testament. The purpose of the law is to help you and I understand our sin. So when the law says, do not commit adultery or do not covet, and then you find yourself coveting, now you become aware that you have sinned. Without the law, what's right, what's wrong, we don't really are sure about that. You know, we have a conscience, we have our cultural upbringings of what's right and wrong. But God gives us very clear a law that tells us do and don't. And then it helps us understand our own sinfulness. And also, it helps us to relate to God and to other people, because they were meant to be a holy nations, a nations of priests, a nations that would reflect the character of God and the time in which they live. Hallelujah. So what about your journey today? Are you on a journey with God? Yes? Okay. Maybe your journey seems long. Maybe it seems painful for sometimes. Maybe you go through some times of discouragement and you face difficulties. But remember that God isn't just trying to keep you alive. It's not God, he's not only interested in just keeping you alive. He's interested in preparing you to a life with him, to a life of devotion, to a life of service. So it's not only I'm alive, or God is on my side. God has a plan and clear indication for us. So that's a bit of an introduction to the book of Deuteronomy. Now let's go to the next slide, and we'll see a word. The first word today, we are going to emphasize three expressions that will summarize the core message of Deuteronomy. And then you know already two of them. Listen, Shema. Shema. Tell your neighbor, are you shmaing? That's a new verb that I just creating. Shema means listen. So are you listening? Are you Shema today? Okay? So tell your neighbor, Shema. These are the words of God. Shema. These are the words. Hallelujah. So this word is found 91 times in the book of Deuteronomy. So when a key, we call it key expression, is repeated that many times, means, oops, let's pay attention to that word. Hallelujah. So the first one is Shema, listen. The second one is remember. And the third one will be never forget, or make sure, be careful not to forget. So these are the three points we're going to do that summarize the message of the book of Deuteronomy. So we have this verse here. This is called Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael. That's what it says here. Now, O Israel, listen carefully and pay attention to the statutes and the judgments which I am teaching you to do, so that you may live and go in and take possession of the land which the Lord, the God of your father, is giving you. Shema Israel are the two first words of the Torah. They are the most important part of the prayer and Judaism. Twice a day, this prayer is going to be prayed, and these are the opening words. It's like, oh, our Father which art in heaven, but this is like Shema Israel, listen Israel, pay attention to your God, pay attention to what the Torah is going to tell you. So that's how this prayer comes. And it's very interesting that it is what the parents are to teach their children to sit before they sleep. And the Shema Israel should be the last words that the Israelites will say at night before they go to bed. Isn't that interesting? You go to sleep, your day is over, Shema Israel. Your children go to bed, Shema Israel. You go to sleep, you thank the Lord. You have lived your life by God's grace. You acknowledge the Lord in your life. Amen. Shema means, next slide, to hear with attention or interest. You know, Shema, listen, it's not just like listening, like you're whistling. Oh, you're whistling very nice. Like, or a bird is, you know, I hear a noise or something. Oh, I hear. And we're all guilty of that. Somebody talks to you, you are hearing, but you're not really listening. Is that right? Especially husband and wives, many times after years of marriage, a wife wants the attention of the husband. The husband is on his computer or doing other things. So we are guilty of that. So here when it says Shema Israel, it's not like, okay, have you heard about it? No. It's like, are you really listening? That's what it means. Listen carefully. Important words are going to be declared here. Shema Israel. Shema you Christian today. Shema believers when you turn into the word of the Lord. Listening with interest. Hallelujah. So ask yourself this morning before we go any further, because that's the main point of our message today. Shema. Are you shmaing really well like God intended you? How do you listen to God? How have you been listening to God? How do you learn? When you come to church, for instance, you are coming here certainly for the one, at least one of the purposes is to learn something from God's word or hearing word. Is that right?
Yes.
Yeah, we come here for a reason. So how do you learn? What's your method? of learning to pay attention to God speaking? What's your method? How do you learn? How much focus, how much importance is it in your daily life? That each night you will say, Shema Israel, or Shema God, like I'm listening to you. In the morning, God, I have my devotion with you. You're the most important treasure in my life. Lord, I'm waking up with you, I'm sleeping with you, I'm living with you. And today, we are at church. So how do you learn? What is your method of learning? How do you do your devotions? Do you take notes? Do you read the Greek and Hebrew dictionary? You know, today it's so easy and we take it so for granted. You have your apps, you're reading in maybe the King James text with the Greek and the Hebrew underlined numbers. You click on that and then you have a full definition of the Hebrew word and the Greek word. It's right there. You don't even have to go and buy a book. You don't even have to turn a page and search. I used to have a big strong concordance, big like that, wide like this, long like this. We used to have it on the fourth floor, and I bought also this kind of books, including all the Hebrew and the Greek words ever of the Bible based on the King James Bible text. Every word, click, definition. Next word, click, definition. But it was really big book. Now you have it just like this. How do you learn? Are you writing? Are you taking notes? When you come to church Sunday morning, are you sleeping? Like I see somebody right now sleeping. Are you sleeping when you come to church on Sunday? Refuse to sleep. Oh, yes, you can be tired. Maybe you slept late Saturday night. Whatever problem you may have in your life, Saturday. Sunday morning, you come to church. You know, sometimes, like last night, I slept at 1:30 in the morning. Okay, do I look like I have slept at 1:30? No, I'm alive. You know, sometimes if I sleep very late, and Pastor Jennifer or somebody else is speaking, you know, sometimes just around 11-ish, you know, your eyes are, this is good, you know. For me, I found a solution. I write notes. I just have my notebook on my shoulder and my pen. Do you know, this is the first picture ever in my life of what a Christian was to be like. I walk in this hospital room. My girlfriend, who is my wife today, but was my girlfriend at the time, her sister was almost died of diabetes, like chronic diabetes, like very, very strict. But she believed in Jesus while at the hospital when Christians witnessed to her. We went to the hospital to discourage her to be a Christian, to bring her back to her good sense, because she was crazy to believe in the Bible. You know, that's how we went in the hospital room. When we entered the hospital room, she was sitting on her bed with her Bible in French and her little mini concordance book and a notebook and a pen. This is the picture that I got that day. This is a Christian. This is what a Christian is like. I don't know, it had a very deep impact on me to see this is a Christian. A Christian has a Bible. A Christian has a pen. A Christian has something to study, and a Christian has a notebook. That is how I started my Christian life. You know that I was unemployed because my job at the time was a seasonal work. I was working in a chocolate factory, and we would be very busy for the Christmas season, chocolate, you know, the Santa Claus chocolate, and the Easter Bunny's chocolate, and then after that, we would be lay off until the fall time, and then we would start all over again. So during the winter, I had a little period of time that I was unemployed. Within just a few months, I was just a brand new baby Christian. I just believe in Jesus. I wrote 3 big size notebook full of scriptures. I had been given a little mini concordance, and I was searching faith, love, God, holy, and write, 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 and write, and write. three big notebooks, big size notebook, completely filled with scriptures. You know what was the result of that? 7 months, I was still a baby Christian, 7 months into my Christian life, I went into a mission trip with my wife. Our baby girl was a baby. Anne was a baby. And we still went with the baby on the mission trip. And I ended up to be the translator. I knew an English, which is French is my mother tongue. I was a brand new Christian, but I knew the scriptures in English and in French enough to translate and quote the scriptures. That is how I started my Christian life. When my friends were having a good time, I was studying the Bible by myself. I just read the Bible. I just wrote and wrote. I was a scribe. I was the whatever. Anyway. Shema Israel, Shema the word of God is the most important thing. How do you listen to the word of God? How do you learn? Do you listen with boredom? I know that, I've read it so many times. Or do you read with curiosity? Do you still have some level of curiosity, of desire to discover and things, desire to learn? Shema means hearing intellectually. Your mind is part of the process. You're not absent-minded. You're focusing, and it is spiritually. And it produces a cause, like it's a cause and effect. You do this carefully. You listen with your mind and with your spirit. It will produce an effect. A cause will come. You will agree. You will yield to, and you will obey. That is the Shema that God intends. So when the Old Testament Torah says Shema, that is what God wants you. There's no other way to listen to the word of God. You cannot be lazy. You cannot be indifferent. You cannot be careless. You cannot be bored. You need to ask God to refresh and to renew always the desire and work like that. This is what it means. Go to the next slide. Moses called all the people of Israel together and says, "Listen carefully, Israel." Again, Shema Israel, listen carefully. Hear the decrees and regulations I am giving you today, so you may learn. Keep, so that you will do it carefully. Listen, learn, keep, and do. To learn here, so that you will learn, means it comes from the word, like if you're a shepherd and you have the sheep or an animal, you have a goad, like a stick. You want your sheep, it's dangerous there, over there, there's a ditch, so move this way a little bit, like go faster. Turn right, turn left. So you goad, you teach, you learn to be skillful by doing that. When it says to keep them, it's another word like Shema. Shema is listen very carefully, put your heart into it, listen with your attention and your mind. Here is the kind of the verb, Shamar. It's the same, the Shema, but here is like be careful to keep, to guard, to apply to your life, to retain, to treasure in your memory. That's the shamar. Be careful. Many times you will have an expression translated like be careful, watch, guard yourself, watch over yourself, watch over the action. Make sure you are really retaining and you are ready to observe it and to do. Deuteronomy 5:10, you know, here God says that he showing steadfast love. God, this is God's side of the deal. Showing steadfast love to thousands of those who what? Love me and shamar. Do you love me? You shamar me, my word? I will show steadfast love on unfailing love. That's the big word of the Old Testament, chesed, mercy, unfailing love, unending love, gracious love, steadfast love. That's what God wants to do. But on your side, he wants you to love him and to shamar his commandments. Hallelujah. Surprisingly, you will see that many times when you read through the book of Deuteronomy, the word love. You will, many times God repeats that He loves us, that He loves Israel. He chose them because He loved them. And He, many times He asks of us, this is a commandment, that we will love Him. Yeah, that's something that is very, very interesting. Hallelujah. Amen. Oh, praise the Lord. We will run out of time for sure this morning. Next slide. Deuteronomy 6:2. This is first the intended blessing, what God desires for them and for us more than anything else, so that you, your children, your grandchildren. Another thing that you will observe in the book of Deuteronomy is the expression, you, your children, your grandchildren, the next generation. The book of Deuteronomy, these words, these are the words. Shema, these are the words. And be careful that you will pass on, that you will practice, and that you will transmit. The book of Deuteronomy commands us over and over and over throughout the books, talking about our children, thinking about our next generation. You know, when you become a grandfather, this becomes very, very meaningful. You realize it even more. You think of the next generation, you think of your children. Now you have the children of your children to think about, to love, to remember their birthdays, and you look at their lives and their personality being formed. You see life differently as you grow in age. But already Deuteronomy is a call to parents and grandparents to take care of the children, to take care of the passing out, to the passing of the these words. These are the words that God wants you to listen, so that you, it will all go well with you. Your life will go well. The blessing, the outflow of God, the prosperity, the peace, the success of your life depend of your Shema, of these precious words of the Lord. Do you understand that? Only Brother Stephen understand. The rest are you sleeping? Hallelujah. I hope not. Hallelujah. If you look at the next verse, you will see Shema. The Lord your God, the Lord is one. This is the prayer that is prayed. When it says the Shema Israel, when the Torah reads, this is actually the text that they use. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. That is the one thing that they declare constantly. You will see it over and over again. You shall love the Lord your God. This is part of the Shema. And if you remember in the Gospel of Mark, when someone approached Jesus, what is the greatest law in the Old Testament? This is what Jesus quoted from, the Shema Israel. This is exactly quoted word for word. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. This is what God wants of you and me more than anything. He wants that of me. He wants that of my children. He wants that of my grandchildren. He wants that so that our country, so that our nation, so that our lives will go well in every aspect of our lives. If we would understand that and put it in practice. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. It's always about the heart. If the words are not in your heart, nothing will work. Even though you know that God has many promises, it's like Christians who have we have one in our home, a promise box. A bunch of verses, they're all positive. It's all God will bless you with this, God will bless you with that, God will give you this, God will give that. And every day you pull one promise box, and then it's like almost like an horoscope. You just put that, oh, today God will bless me with this, oh, tomorrow God will bless me with that. It's not what we are talking about. We're talking about the heart. As you will love the Lord, and it starts with the heart. It goes with the emotions, and it goes with our strength, with the usefulness of our body. And these words shall be on your heart. That's why you need to Shema. You need to Shema, otherwise you will not get it. And you shall teach them diligently to your children. Yes. And you will talk about it when you sit at your home, when you relax after the day of work. Maybe it's not really what we're doing. We're watching TV, we're on the internet, we're doing other things, reading the news. But God says, when you sit at home, spend your time more on these are the words of God. Live them out, share with them. When you go to sleep, when you wake up in the morning, share with your children. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Let's try to go a bit faster. Next slide. There's a bunch of scriptures here. I will not spend a lot of time, but like giving you an example. The first one, if you will Shema Shema, double Shema, okay? This is what happens here. You will remember that word today after we finish this sermon. And if you Shema Shema, my commandments, it stressed the importance. It's a repeat. It stressed the importance. If you listen, if you really listen, really carefully, amen? The word that I command you today, what is it that God commands us? No, yes, Shema, yes, but what is it, this commandment that he wants us to Shema, Shema?
Love.
It is love. This is what God wants us to do. Amen. You're getting there. You're getting there. If you look at the next one, you will have the chapter 12. No, I mean the verse and line. Shamar Shama. That's like, again, it's like a repeat, but like it's the verb and the expression of super stressing it. Be careful to hear. Be careful when you listen. Super diligently, super. Yeah, make it the word super over there before that. Amen. The next one talks about a warning, Shamar, and the next one about verse 15 here. Only, you see, there's a condition, there's blessing, there is conditions that will come only if you Shamar Shama. Only if you Shamar Shama. Okay, you remember that? Shema Shema. Oh no, this one is like only if you Shema Shema, the voice of the Lord your God, to Shamar with care. Okay, so you have Shema, Shema, and Shamar in that verse over there. So you better be careful. And it is only if you put that in practice that all of the promises of God will come to you. Point number two, remember. 15 times in the book of Deuteronomy, remember. Major emphasis, remember. Israel was told to remember their history, good and bad, to learn the lessons from the past. They were instructed to remember God's personal intervention, God's deliverance, salvation. They were also to remember the miracles. They were okay to remember also all the God provisions during their walk. They were going to learn also the lessons from their fathers, because now we're talking to the new generation, huh? So learn. Remember by remembering your history, by what happened to your father. Actually, in the book of Deuteronomy, there is more emphasis on the negative warning, on the curses, than on the blessing. And there's a reason for that. Why? Because God loves you and me so much. It's like the verse in Hebrew that says, how can we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? That's the kind of heart of Moses and God is telling us. If you don't Shamar, Shema, and Shamar my word and live it out, you will not inherit the blessing, but you will be with the curse. You will perish like them. So remember. Remember the history. Remember the negative lessons. And we are warned on that in the book of Corinthians and the New Testament. Look at the Old Testament. Learn. Look at the... If today you hear the voice, do not harden your heart as they have done. in the past, and they have perished in the wilderness. You see, by not Shema, the word, it will turn out to be a disobedient and rebellious heart. You are not paying attention. You are not careful to put all of your energy into the these are the words of God. So then it will vanish, it will fade away, and then you will end up living a life of mediocrity, as a spiritual life of mediocrity. A life that is not honoring God. A life that is flirting with sinfulness. And if you flirt with sinfulness, the devil is cunning enough to bring you more to the next step into that sinfulness. And then what God will do? Judgment. You are being depriving yourself of the blessing, the fullness, the abundant life. The devil came to destroy, to steal, and to kill. But the good shepherd came to give life and the abundant life. This, you and I are destined to abundant life. And the book of Deuteronomy repeats it over and over again, so that all may go well with you. Remember the lessons of your life. Remember the past. And if you look at the Deuteronomy 5:15, remember that you were once slaves in Egypt. This is one of the things you need to remember. And this is also repeated throughout Deuteronomy many times. Remember Egypt. Remember that you were a slave in Egypt. Remember how God brought you out of Egypt. Remember this. Remember that you were a slave in Egypt is repeated many, many times in Deuteronomy. Remember how the Lord your God led you. How the Lord, you know, touch your heart and bring you to this direction, so that the doors that he opens, how he leads you to the wilderness, how he provides for you, how he proves your character, even with the tough test of life. There is a reason why God sometimes allows times that are not so easy for us. Deuteronomy 8:18. Remember the Lord. Remember who God is. Remember who you're dealing with. Deuteronomy 32:7. Remember the days of long ago, your past history, about the generation past. Ask your father. And here it's not only asking about the traditions and the culture of your country. It's about the religious knowledge. It's about these words that were passed through Abraham, then Moses, the law, now to the new generation. Look to that kind of history. Look to the past. Ask your father. Ask about how they knew God, how they live out their life. Learn from the life of other Christians. Learn from your Christian root. Learn from Judaism. That's why the exhibit is so wonderful. If you haven't been there, you are missing a lot of privilege. This has come here to be a blessing. You go through and you see proofs and, you know, things that tells you the history of how the documents are so accurate and been preserved, and the life of the people of the Bible. And it is so wonderful. So your past here is about your religious past, the history of Judaism and Christianity. Remember the Lord. Remember your story. Remember where you come from. Remember what the Lord has repeatedly asked of you in the past, but you went the other way around. Is that happening to you? Since you have become a Christian, these are the words. Never change, always the same. So God speaks to us, but we don't obey. God speaks to us, but we are not Shema to the Lord's words. We just ignore or go on or follow our friends, follow our culture, follow whatever is trendy, follow the worldview, or follow whatever, except really what God. And many of us have been called, many of us have been stirred up at some times by the word of God, but it's not really there anymore. So that is a question. Remember what the Lord has repeatedly asked of you in the past and you got sidetracked. Remember your roots. Remember the people of the past. When was it the last time you read a good biography of godly men and women? Missionary biographies are so, so encouraging. Or people who have translated the Bible. Or devotionals about the Christian history. People who have suffered for their faith, so that we enjoy knowing God and having so many Bibles. That's why I brought so many Bibles here. You We have these Bibles, the King James here. We have translated out of the original tongues and with previous translations diligently compared and revised. Who done that? I just go to the bookstore and I buy it and I read it. It's free. Or I receive it as a gift. But there's so much blood in this book here. There's so much blood that has been shed that you get a Bible in English. Do you know if you are Tagalog speakers, or Cebuano, Ilocano, do you know the history of the translation of your Bible? I'm sure everybody in the room will say no. Should it be important to you to know? The people, maybe missionaries, I don't know from your country, maybe local people that really went to study and spend years of their life. Did you know that the Jerome, who gave us one, the mother of all modern Bible versions in Latin, and the year 389, I think, was commissioned by a pope. At that time, there was Latin was becoming kind of the common language because it was the Roman Empire. And there was a lot of bits and pieces of translations, but the standards of translation, there's a lot of confusions, a lot of mistakes. So the Pope asked Jerome, okay, he was a scholar, he was a great, great scholar. Will you give us a standardized Latin? So he went there, but he went beyond that. Do you know what he did? He left his life, he moved to Jerusalem from Rome, and he spent 23 years of his life learning Hebrew, Aramaic. Have you done that already? Move to another place and learn the language so that you can be efficient and to do something. People of the past have done that. And do you know that his Bible version has become the Bible that has been significant the longest of all time? Many of the first English Bible translation were translated not from the Hebrew and the Greek, they were translated from Jerome's Latin Bible. His Bible was the most influential and it has become the common language Bible of the time. He did something really revolutionary at the time. He gave the common people, he influenced the culture. His Bible was significant for 1,000 years. Then the Reformation came. Even 500 years after the Reformation, his Bible was still studied and referred to. That is a wonderful story. We get it and we don't know where it comes from. We don't care and we don't really pay attention to any of the inheritance. This is worth, this is, your Bible is worth more than gold and silver. It is worth more than fame. It is more than a successful business. It is worth more than anything. It is more than a university degree. It is worth more than anything else. This is your life. One of the last verse of the book of Deuteronomy, it says, this is your life. These words are not idle. They are not empty. This is your word. It's part of these words. These are the words. These are the words. They are not empty. This is your life. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. But all of us, I think, has this... we passed our time already. Wow, so many things. We have to continue another time. And I have so many testimonies to say also. Hallelujah. Father God, we want to thank you, Lord, this morning to remind us the treasure that we so often look at with not contempt, but take for granted, and we are so careless. When these are the words that we need to listen intently, diligently, careful, so that we will come to love you, come to know you. And Lord, you exhort us to remember our story, where we're coming from. Oh Lord, when we get sidetracked. Lord God, hallelujah. Thank you for the book of Deuteronomy that emphasizes to me today, this morning, the importance of God's word. Lord, I must confess that so many times I didn't give much attention. Even while reading or doing a daily devotion, my heart was somewhere else. But Lord, today help me to see the word with new eyes. These are the words. This is the theme that in this morning you are calling us to Shema your word, Lord. Intently, Lord. Help us to have this yielding heart, carefulness, giving our attentions like these scribes of old that have accurately copied the word of God, even if they had to give their own life. All these people that provided for this Bible and so many languages of our mother tongue. Thank you, Lord, that your word has reached our nations, that we could know you, our Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah.